We have an interesting story to tell, and I'm trying to put it in the textbook and framework of innovation, because as it relates to sort of the subject matter of these lectures and the theory of the role of innovation, I submit to you, and I guess the thought here is that it's never been more important than now. And certainly all of us are living through, hopefully, better days than a year ago, but this extraordinary macroeconomic crisis has certainly put the pressure on companies to, I would say, hunker down as opposed to be bold. And I think those companies that have and can be innovative and understand that innovation is the solution and the path out, not cutting and not being on the defense, but that innovation is actually the key to navigating the shifting economic landscape and winning. So that's sort of the thesis that I have. And you know, we always talk on all companies, whether you're in the tech industry or whatever industry you're in, the thought is sustainability. I mean, everybody can have a one-year wonder or even a two-year wonder, but this is actually just a quick snapshot of the percent of companies with sustained profitable growth who were able to, over 10 years, grow revenue at over 5% real growth. That's 27%, but only 16% were able to do it and grow their profit in that kind of real growth over time, and less than that earning their cost of capital. So the thought is that over a longer period of time, it's not that easy. That it takes innovation and the constant reinvention and innovation, and it's not just one year or one product, but and if you look at a decade, not that easy to keep it up. And in that thought, innovation leaders are the ones that are able to stand out. And it is about extraordinary management of growth on the top line, not necessarily just profitability and cost control, that allows you to outperform peers. So market caps are 4 times, operating income almost 4 times, gross profit 3 times, sales more than 2.5 times, and total shareholder return over 2 times the peers across the key metrics when you are in fact truly an innovative company. And you know, everybody, all business leaders are writing about it. A.G. Laffley, the chairman but former CEO of P&G, wrote a book on innovation. And this, I think, quote, all of us agree with this thought, that simply put, innovation is a prerequisite for sustained growth. There is no other path, and it has to occur across the enterprise, not just in your R&D facility, but just that every function, every leader in the organization has to have an innovative mindset in order to achieve sustained growth. So kind of taking the lens through our story, you know, we're very proud that, again, I guess Business Week last year, of the top 50 performers, ranked the company number 13 based on average return on capital and growth over 36 months. But I think that the capsule about it was that for a 125-year-old company, that our mindset was to try and make it 125 years new as opposed to 125 years old. And that is a journey unto itself, a personal journey of reinvention as leaders. I'll talk about that at the end, but also of the company and its strategies. And we have had to imbue a culture of innovation to be successful. And I'll just a couple aside here, but I have the privilege of being on the Apple board, clearly an innovative company, but a newer company. And so it's an interesting thing to come back from those board meetings and understand sort of the culture of innovation, certainly, and the leading edge consumer use and touch and products that I think hopefully you are all users of some form of an Apple product. But to do that in a company that's 125 years old, as opposed to a, you know, Silicon Valley moment, it's more difficult. You know, it's taking a company that was actually incepted in 1886 on a very actual innovative thought at the time. And that was that our founder believed, before women could vote, that they should have an opportunity to be economically independent. That actually was the founding innovative thought. Yes, we sell lipsticks. Yes, we sell fragrance and skincare. But the very first foundational innovation of the company, and it was bold and it was risky. And you know, I use that word carefully because today risk, certainly with all of the TARP issues, et cetera, is perceived as a negative. But there is an aspect, not of risk, but of bold, courageous moves that can define industries and define companies. And our founder believed that women could do something outside the home, and it was heresy at the time. All direct sales agents were men, and no women really worked outside of the home and earned economic independent income. And so that really was the first innovative thought of Avon in 1886. And again, 120, almost 5 years later, we have 6 million going up, independent women in every corner of the globe who, first and foremost, before they even sell lipstick, are economically independent, are small entrepreneurs, we're a huge micro lender. And that thought came from the most innovative thought in 1886. But if I just take the last decade of since I've been leading the company, really it does start with product innovation. I mean, at the end of the day, if you don't have extraordinarily innovative products that people want, the rest becomes very difficult. So the product, if you would, and the product innovation was very important. And when I was handed the CEO job, or actually when I first came to the company before that, there was this huge tome of research that had been done in the company for the first time that essentially said, to cut through it all, ding dong, Avon calling my grandmother's brand. And the worst part of it was when you translated it in Spanish, where we have terrific market shares in Latin America, even there, the translation was a brand for my maid. So I thought, oh my goodness, what have I done? This is not gonna be a fun job. But we had, you know, squarely faced it on to say, on the other hand, back to the founding principle, extraordinary power. Everybody knows Avon. Nobody didn't know it. It was a household name all over the world. It was just very dated, and in an industry that is expecting innovation in products, image, aspiration, again, it was becoming very dated and old. But we took on the thought in the first decade to change that image. And I'm proud to say that, again, after this decade of work, that included a major investment, as I'll show you, in research and innovation in products, in celebrities, but we are one of the top 100 brands. There's only one other beauty company, Chanel, which has more products than that, on this brand, and the only direct selling company in the top 100 brands, alongside Coca-Cola, Apple, Amazon, Google, Microsoft. So again, we're proud of that. But it was a mindset, is my point. You know, anything that you are doing, it can be done. There's a few very dated brands. We were one of them, is my only point. In 1990, hip, chic women did not want to buy Avon. But the premise, the foundational thought of the company was strong and good, and with innovation, we could make this kind of turn. When I love to do the Sunday New York Times crossword puzzle. When I started with the company, four letters, the second letter was V, and the clue would be ding dong. Two years ago, it was four letters, the second letter was V, and the clue was the company for women, and I thought, there's my report card, I'm sending it to the board. So that I needed to send them that, versus my P&L was my company for women crossword puzzle, because it does take that long to change the mind through innovation and perception. So we today have now 90% brand awareness around the world. We sell, it's kind of four lipsticks every second, that's what we like to say, four lipsticks every second of the day, every day of the year. We're a pioneer today in anti-aging skincare. Innovation and technology is a big part of that. We will take away your wrinkles. And we're number one in fragrance across our developing and emerging world. We invested well over $100 million up in Suffern, New York, to have a leading world-class research and development facility. Lots of beauty brands are up in today, but very few corporations have the heft and the capital investment potential to put money against the R as well as the D, which is critical in terms of ensuring the breakthrough technology in our categories. And this is not about looking at each little small picture, but the point is that we have a very robust but disciplined requirement of the breakthrough technologies every year in the company. And so this is a grid that we need a culture, not just in our R&D facility, but across our sales representatives, our marketing, in terms of what are the key technologies that have broken through to forward the anti-aging claims that we have. And really, since the very beginning of the 90s, we've come out with some terrific breakthrough technologies that have really put us on the map and made a difference. So from product innovation and technology, that is a key. Then we also needed to change the image of the company. So in addition to the fact that 65% of our R&D today is focused on innovation, and that's up since even 2006, and we have had this year over 15 sort of first to market breakthrough technologies in our category, we have combined them with innovative marketing. So if you thought it was your grandmother's brand, Reese Witherspoon, for instance, is our spokesperson, our face of the Avon brand, not who you might have thought was associated with Avon a few years ago. Patrick Dempsey, for those of you who watch Grey's Anatomy, McDreamy, is a face for us in men's. Again, not who you would associate with Avon. And when you've combined the technology and the products that are highly efficacious but very affordable with that kind of imagery, and we've invested against it, that combination has led to the fact that the brand image has turned around. So that really was sort of the first part of the culture of innovation for us. The second wasn't necessarily about products, but that we have had a commitment to be innovative in terms of where we distribute. When I came to this company in the mid-90s, the concept of doing business in the emerging markets, where there was a lot of risk, a lot of economic and political volatility, was not popular. So we were getting a ding, if you would, from Wall Street on what today has become very au courant, which is the emerging market opportunity. But Brazil, with macroeconomic crises and currency fluctuation, we've been in Latin America for 55 plus years, huge share, but there was a moment where that was not perceived as a good thing. That was a risk profile. Same thing in Eastern Europe. I mean, I remember that I wasn't the CEO, but I was in Russia at the time where the ruble devalued and a lot of competitors were pulling out of the market because considered too much risk to do business there. Today, it's the second largest market in the world for us, almost $800 million, making nearly $200 million. I mean, that's the kind of engine, because we've stayed the course and we believed, and we were innovative in our approach to making money and staying the course in the emerging and developing world before it became popular. And so because of that, today, where everybody is competitive and wanting to do business in BRIC or Brazil, Russia, India, and China, we have had, in many cases, a lead advantage over the last decade, so that we're number one in Latin America, number one in Central and Eastern Europe, and we have strong growing businesses in India and China because we were innovative and bold enough to place bets on that 10 to 15 years ago before it became popular. And then now, here's Goldman Sachs research, but now everybody is going to follow, you know, because BRIC or Brazil, Russia, India, China countries will be the only source, the only source of domestic demand growth globally in 2009. In 2010, we project that for three consecutive years, we will have seen global demand expansion led by these economies. So being in a first mover position 10 or 15 years ago has yielded, in a very difficult economic environment in 2009, those markets have so outperformed that the company has been able to weather much of the issues that have gone on for others. So if you look at beauty growth, and they project through 2013, 83% of the growth that's projected for anyone using makeup, cosmetics, skin, is going to be in the developing and emerging world. All, basically, of the growth that is projected is coming from consumption and consumers in the developing and emerging markets. And this is where, again, that innovation bet we made is that we are double the percent of our business is in those markets. So therefore, we're going to get an outsized share of growth over the next 5 years because of a bet we made, as I said, a long time ago, and therefore we're number one in these kind of economies. The third innovation, again, so there's sort of product innovation, innovation as it relates to being first geographically, which was not necessarily popular and a bet not everyone was making in the early 90s. The third is really innovation of the business model and restructuring for operational excellence. My own personal story, the first 5 years, as Fred said, the 10 years you do see cycles. You do see your industry cycles and your own cycles. And the first 5 years as the CEO, I think it was 10 or 12% top line compounded growth, 22% earnings growth. I really was hired in to be a growth an expansion CEO, and then we hit the wall in my, I guess, sixth year, 2005, and I really had to develop a completely new mindset and set of skills in the same job. And here I was saying I really was not a cost queen or a turnaround expert by any stretch of the imagination, but that's what the company did right there. So I actually had a CEO sort of coach counselor who said to me in that year, he said to me, you know, you need to reinvent yourself. Your first innovation has to be of yourself. You can innovate this company, but if you don't have, I mean, many people have the unfortunate situation where in order to turn around a company, they have to bring in a new CEO who's got kind of completely objective mindset, doesn't have any baggage or thinking of what, you know, what how we used to do things or how we do things here. And he said, if you can, and this was his actual advice to me, and it's interesting, I share it with you. If he said, it was a Friday evening, it was like 9 o'clock, we were just the two of us in my office. He said, if you can go home as if you fired yourself tonight and come in on Monday morning as if you were new, as if the board just brought you in to have new eyes, a new lens, to look at your team, your strategies, your organizational structure, fresh. If you can be that innovative, but also have had the experience that you've had for almost a decade at the company, it will be a phenomenal turnaround. If you can't reinvent or innovate your own leadership style, even though you've been in the job, then it becomes much more difficult. And that was probably one of the very critical and inflection point pieces of advice that I got sort of halfway into my decade, which was that we needed to completely be innovative in how we ran the business, how we structured the business, how we took costs out, and nothing except the values and the vision and the principles was untouchable. Everything else had to be looked at, and everything else was fair game. So in 05 to 08, we really, for the sort of second chapter of my CEO-ship, innovated the whole business process and business model. And we realized at that moment that we were challenged because, you know, it's hard enough to be a competitor of Walmart. And it's hard enough to be a competitor of, just say, P&G, Unilever. But to have both of them as your competitors when you are a vertical company, that's really difficult. So our people used to say to me, exactly who are we competing against, Andrea? And I used to say, well, every single day a consumer can choose to go to Walmart instead of buy an Avon product, or she can choose to buy an Oil of Olay product from P&G, you know, where it's more accessible and she's on aisle three. So we have a huge task at hand, team, because we have to beat them both. That's a pretty big, tall order for us. And how are we going to do that? We have to be the best consumer brand and operate as well as P&G, for example, and also be as powerful and competitive a channel as the Walmarts and the Targets, et cetera. And so we decided we were not organized properly to do that. We had people trying to do both, that the whole organization was trying to be get the best product out there at the lowest cost and be the most exciting at the point of sale. And you know, people were not only exhausted but ineffective at being able to compete on all those fronts. So we said we really have to divide the organization into, and those of you I'm looking, I'm sure, have your own experiences of to make that kind of cultural change in a company where we're saying, you used to do this before, Dan, but you're not going to do it anymore. You used to have all of this in your kingdom, and now you're only going to do these functions, not these, because Noreen's going to do another, she's going to do that part, and the two of you, 1 + 1 = 3, because we'll be the best at both. But it meant taking roles and responsibilities away from people. In a culture of a company, that was really very difficult. But it was the innovative catalyst needed to ready ourselves to grow again. So we basically took an organization and we asked them to split, to divide and focus on the consumer versus the commercial. And we flattened our organization, which was very difficult. But we had sort of 15 layers. We took out 1/3 of management at that time and had 14 layers and reduced it because the goal here was that to be innovative, you've got to be close to the consumer. And that when you're $10 million, it's easy to kind of build infrastructure in a company. And we realized we were not alone in that thought of bureaucracy, if you would, and that speed, being really innovative, means being just close to the consumer, close to your clients. I mean, and if you build any layers in there, you then become further and further away. So we flattened the organization. We freed up $1 billion of cost over these period of time to put back into advertising and, you know, celebrities, et cetera. And our revenues grew again. Our beauty revenues grew almost double digits. Our active sellers were up very healthily. And then, as you can see, our margins, our gross margin and our operating margin over these 3 years really changed because we were innovative in the operating structure, not just the products. And then came 2009. So just as we were claiming victory on this wonderful, innovative operating structure and plan, all of us a year ago kind of ran smack into the global economic headwinds of the worst crisis any of us have imagined. And so you've read all the headlines. So, you know, there was everything from manufacturing tumbling and the global, quote, recession, credit squeeze, obviously, job layoffs, currency volatility, which really affected us, and consumer contraction. And this was not isolated to the United States, but really projected and predicted just about in every market around the world. And certainly, you know, every business leader had to face the thought that certainly from a government and economist point of view, that these we would be walking into the worst financial crisis and the toughest for consumer companies, consumer contraction experienced in decades and decades. What we decided to do, though, is really focus on the opportunity. And that, I think, is the beginning of the innovative thought. So we had the meeting like every other management group at the end of last year that would say, how are we going to hunker down? Business is going to be tough. What are we going to save on? You know, how are we going to manage through this year? And I realized after a few of those meetings that if we didn't put innovation and excitement and motivation back into the optimism of the team, that we weren't going to gain share in the year. So we said, look, just a minute here. In the worst times in history, it is proven that that is when the biggest shifts, negatively and positively, of market share happen. In other words, if business is good and you're a large company, to gain a point of market share, I mean, it's a war out there, but you don't see these disruptive share changes. And that in recessions, there are more casualties, but more heroes. That people gain a huge amount of share, or businesses or industries can go out and down in recessions in those kind of cycles, and that we wanted to be on the right-hand side of this chart, gaining share in a disproportionate way than we would normally. And the team was sort of like, what are you expecting us to do? And we said, we're going to win. We're going to make, in a time when the world is full of questions, we are going to have to show that we have an innovative way to be the answer. So. This is how we did it.
In this dire economy, Avon is actually growing the number of people who are out there ringing on doors. So we wanted to know how you become part of it, how you make money, and how you get up the nerve to ring that first doorbell. For $10, Dawn joined Avon. And she says in her first week going door to door, she pocketed $800.
I was amazed. I was astonished. I didn't think it could be possible. I thought I'd make just a little extra pocket money. And here I was making a significant amount of money.
I've done a lot of research. I've asked a lot of people. And what really comes back to me a lot is this direct selling.
It is a cosmetics company and so much more. In these tough economic times, it's a lifeline for families looking to make ends meet.
Hanımlarının geleneksel günleri artık güzelliğin hizmetinde. Her ay bir araya gelen hanımların evlerine konuk olan satış temsilcisi hem makyaj tüyoları veriyor hem de bütçesine katkıda bulunuyor.
Avon provides the opportunity to make extra income on your own schedule, being your own boss, and for only $10 you're in business.
This is Angie Winter, and she's out selling door to door in Camborne near Cambridge.
Serena Chu works for the DMV, but when the full-time students' hours got slashed, she heard Avon calling.
After being laid off from her job, one Metro woman turned a hobby of selling Avon into a $325,000 business.
I need to earn some extra money without compromising what I believe in being a mother and a parent. All of a sudden, the idea just popped in my head that name Avon, just I was like, Avon, I'm gonna do Avon.
So if you couldn't read some of this translation, it was all the same story, that this was the way, in a moment where the economy was causing unemployment, to give the solution, that our innovation as a company was going to be more people than in our hundred and whatever year history being offered the opportunity to have Avon be the solution to the economic crisis, okay, that we were going to be government's answer. Well, they were working on stimulus packages and employment. We were going to say, you got laid off, you're now part-time hours instead, you don't have to have an income issue. And that became the, quote, innovation of 2009. And the representative Dawn, you know, we said she's one of 6 million representatives, you know, who are turning to us right now in a challenging economy. She's, you know, really an example that the most innovative answers sometimes come from your roots, and the roots are we offer earnings opportunities. And so that was the power of the company. So we literally do this every month. We do job losses and number of people who come to Avon. So in every part of our company, on any given month, we will be showing, example, in the United Kingdom, second quarter, 271,000 layoffs. We added 44,000 jobs. In Mexico, 169,000 jobs were lost in Mexico, the country, between April and June, and we almost countered that one for one. 158,000 people joined Avon to earn. And so this became a KPI or a metric for us throughout this year, with a lot of pride, by the way, as you can imagine, that our people were like, we're part of the solution here. We are giving jobs where jobs are being lost. So the thought here was the innovation was going to be, we're going to be the biggest engine of opportunity. And we said, look, credit's drying up as well. You can't get loans for small businesses. We're going to have more cash loaned out there. We're going to be microfinancers, if you would, and be the largest microlender to women in a time when credit for women, especially small business owners, is also drying up. We also said we're going to be affordable. That, you know, again, if you look at all the lipsticks out there, you know, Avon is not $25 or $55. Avon is a great lipstick you can get for $6 or $8, so you do not have to spend in a world where in the United States savings levels are now 5%. You know, people are saving money. They don't need to spend as much money on the category. So we really just focused on recruiting and on great value in our products. So we went for something quite new, which was advertising this opportunity, not only on television, but online efforts. So examples would be, a year ago, if you type in skincare anti-aging on Google, Avon would pop up. Today, if you type in on any search engine, part-time job, need money, employment, you get Avon. So we spent to buy the search engines for understanding that people want the solution to earnings. And as you saw from Diane Sawyer, et cetera, all over the world, we really launched a major public relations campaign to say, this is a solution. So we doubled the amount of advertising on this. And then another innovative moment was, I'm looking at Ellen Slicklin here from our team, but we've never advertised on the Super Bowl, okay? We just said, that's for Budweiser. And when people said, why are you, what? First of all, our team was like, we're gonna advertise on the Super Bowl. And then the second thing they said was, so what are we advertising? A new skincare or the lipstick? And we said, neither. We're gonna advertise the earnings opportunity. There are gonna be as many women watching pregame and this was January, February, you remember, this was the heart of the real crisis and the real unemployment and the fear of unemployment was at its height. So we ran a 30-second recruiting spot, and this was it.
If someone asks me how they can make money right now, I say, do what I'm doing. Sell Avon.
It's just a great way to earn extra money.
It makes sense to sell Avon. Avon is an American icon.
It propelled me into taking that leap of faith.
Avon is everything to me. I can't get fired. I can't get laid off. It's my business.
In my first couple weeks, I sold over $800 with Avon.
I used that to pay for all my bills, phone bills, and everything.
Avon changed my life. It can change yours, too. Call your representative today and start the new year off right.
So you can imagine, in that moment, the two lines, I can't get laid off, I can't get fired. A huge recall. The phone was ringing off the hook before halftime. And it began the catalyst for the largest $130 million of impressions in media.
Two North Texans are getting their moment in the spotlight during the Super Bowl this Sunday. You're not going to see them on the field, but you'll watch them starring in their own Super Bowl ad. The Avon representatives are both featured in the company's first ever Super Bowl commercial.
Earn extra money.
Even in these tough times,
the women typically watch the Super Bowl to watch the commercials. I mean, they're exciting, they're interesting. It's a social event.
The commercials air right after the singing of the national anthem and just before kickoff.
Pretty innovative, right? So that was one of our innovations. And just to start with the 24%, that's sort of 24% more people joined us than a year ago. I mean, that is what happened, and it was done like this worldwide, and it began. Again, the largest inflow of people interested in the business. In terms of pricing, the point here was that, you know, we wanted to be affordable. And we knew around the world that having things that were less than $5 as well as over $10 were important and that people were conscious of their pocketbooks. And we advertised, this would be the UK, but the thought is why, if you go shopping, it costs you, on the left, petrol, but how much does it cost you in gas? And gasoline is expensive. So how much gas does it cost you to go to the mall? How much is parking? Okay, you're going to stand in line, and if you have to get something returned, you've got to drive again and pay that gas all over again. That's on the left. If you buy from Avon, it's brought to you, it's picked up, you don't have any of those costs. So the thought here was to actually also be innovative in saying it's a much more cost-effective shopping experience. And this is just, these are the first three quarters of the year. Gray is first quarter, blue is second, and pink is third. But L'Oreal is a large competitor, would be on the left. Estee Lauder, it's the third column there, and then Avon is on the right. So again, I think with this innovative focus, we have outperformed all other beauty companies in this year, where even if they say lipsticks are recession-proof, other beauty companies are struggling because people are shrinking their purchases, including on cosmetics, in a year like this. But we have done, I think, well because of the innovative approach I said that we just took. And this is also working outside the United States. And the way I would just look at this is the gray is GDP, and the pink is our growth. So, for example, in Russia, just the second bar, you know, we're growing 12%. Of the economy is shrinking 9%, so it's 21 points difference between how Avon is growing and how the economy is growing. And if I pick, I'll just take another country, Turkey, growing 12%, the economy is down 5%. So the economy is mostly shrinking in most markets in the emerging world, and this model is working. So now what do? Because we feel like we've had the innovative approach to kind of weather through 2009, and what's next? So the last or current chapter of innovation is really capturing this structural shift. So what we're saying now is we better not just get lazy. Okay, the economy will probably recover, hopefully, and we don't want to just have that be an episodic momentary opportunity. There is wealth curve shifts, technology shifts, product innovation shifts. This moment is one to really rethink our strategies. And what we've basically said is we're going to innovate the portfolio, and I'll talk about that in a minute. And that is because 84% of consumers care much more now about what they buy. And another way to say it is, being a value shopper is cool. All right? And then being a luxury, high-end shopper was cool a decade ago. But right now, kind of forced by this economy, most consumers are saying, you know what? I go to Costco even if I'm driving a Mercedes-Benz. The concept of saving money is across all tiers and all demographics. If you can find innovation in the product, and if the product quality is good, why spend a lot of money? That is a new consumer mindset in beauty and in every other category, I believe, in consumer, and that is here to stay. And they believe that they will not necessarily spend more. Even if the Dow goes back over 14,000, consumers are saying, I'm not necessarily trading back up to spending, you know, hundreds of dollars on X if I found a very good value at under 100. And that is a very important structural perception of consumers that we wanted to capitalize on. And so then we said, this is an opportunity. So we are, again, just pushing forward in innovation and technology, again, with anti-aging skincare that's under $50. You know, there are fabulous creams out there for over 100, but people who are finding a great, innovative product for $36, they're going to stay with it. And we're extending that into color and personal care. Packaging innovation is important. So here was sort of our packaging before, and here it is afterwards. And so no cost difference. And I just, for those of you in sort of consumer product design, and this is one of the things from Apple that I think our team has learned, it can look beautiful for the exact same cost. Aesthetics is not cost. Aesthetic is insensibility. That on the right is the same cost of goods as that on the left, and it wholly looks different. One looks very prestige, one does not, and that has been extraordinarily important in the thought of innovation in packaging drives consumer behavior. And that's driven, just the packaging change has driven our sales up 12%. Innovation is important, and partnerships are important. As I said, the concept of, for us, having partners or celebrities really speak to the Avon brand has been new. So from men's celebrities to designer celebrities, Courtney Cox, Reese Witherspoon, this has added, just in a couple of years, $750 million of sales in fragrances or products that are endorsed by these celebrities. So that was very new for us. And we've actually just signed Fergie, who is our first, quote, music celebrity. But, you know, for us, hip-hop, Avon, I mean, again, disconnect if you think about it back 10 years ago. But this is bringing us younger consumers. The internet, as well as this, are driving a different mentality into a new generation. We're also looking at the men's business, the sun care business, wellness business, businesses that we are not in as terms of being innovative now that we have these people in our franchise. And then very importantly, technology. Lastly, I'll just say that this basically says that in the pink, the business model, the distribution model innovation actually, I think, is going to be the game changer. I would say to you that brand innovation and technology innovation in the consumer space are now the cost of entry. If you don't have the best product, it's game, set, match. But if you can win, he or she who really nails innovation in distribution and understands the role of technology in tomorrow's distribution is going to win the model of share gains. And I won't go through all these, but you know these numbers, I'm sure most of you, in terms of the internet usage, how many users, 1.3 billion users, 86% of them are outside the US, growing 30% a year, wireless innovation and social media. We've got to stay ahead of that. I mean, just two-thirds of the internet population is on a social networking site today, yes? There are 200 million Facebook users growing at some staggering rate per month. A year ago, I would not be able to say to you that there are 1.6 billion Twitter messages out there. That is a new phenomenon. And 100 million videos are viewed every month in the United States on YouTube. That shift and change was one that we said, if we don't deal with that, even though we're doing well right now, we too could be obsolete. So we looked at even just email. This would say if you are 15 to 24 in the pink, you are using social networking sites, email is becoming a thing of the past. That is the thought. The next generation, email is historic. Now we're into, again, a very different morphing of technology. And most of the United States markets, it's happening at a rapid speed in emerging and developing markets. In China, it's become the global internet leader in less than 15 years. And online sales in our category are growing also exponentially. So we said we've got to use the web or internet to really change the business model and innovate in this space. And we said to ourselves, look, we started off in home, but actually we were the first social network. Before technology, woman to woman, Avon was the original social network, of the original community space. And then we had to follow her to work in the 70s, and now we better be online, which is the new community, to be relevant and innovate once again after 125 years. So we think that we can combine high touch and high tech and vastly explode, if you would, how many people we can recruit and how we can market. So examples would be we could use the web to allow every Avon representative to make her own business website. And she could publish, so if the commercial that you saw that the company generated that we would traditionally run on NBC and the normal networks, we give her that commercial. She publishes it on her own website. That website is integrated with her social network. So if she has 100 friends, okay, she then takes that commercial and 100 friends see her feed. They each have 100 friends, and that's a low average. And then all of a sudden you have obviously 10,000 views for no cost to this company times 6 million representatives who have this. This is where the viral potential, if you would, innovating one commercial we created for traditional media goes to a very exponential place. And that to me is the same thing you can do with marketing. You could take a product commercial and do the very same thing. And you can enable lifelong connections with your community. So I'll just close by saying all of these things are sort of in our story. I'm sure they're no different in yours. It is about taking a company that's 125 years old and making it new through reinvention and innovation. At the beginning and the end of it is of innovative leadership. If you're not an innovative leader individually, you cannot have an innovative company, no matter if you're a year old or 100 years old. And the last two quotes I would say is that the problem is never how to get new innovative thoughts in your mind, but how to get old ones out. Every mind is a building filled with archaic furniture. Clean out a corner of your mind, and creativity will instantly fill it. And then lastly, let go of assumptions and biases, continually reinvent, because just as energy is the basis of life itself, and ideas are the source of innovation, so is innovation the vital spark of all human change, improvement, and progress. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andrea.
Technology.
What a great talk. And I know we're running a bit late, so I'm going to ask folks to ask very, very brief questions so we can get as many in before Andrea has to go. Okay, so please raise your hand and wait for the mic.
Of course, I have to ask the obvious. I bet you are asked this all the time. Do you use Avon products?
Yes, I do. Very proudly. No, and the reason is because we have a multi-level system where they were actually bringing them in and getting a percent. So for them, this was an extraordinarily exciting time, and we're paying them to help train and motivate. When you bring in that many millions more, we, the employed sales force, could not train and develop. So we were giving our existing representatives the opportunity to be a part of that. So it was a win for them, too. Mike.
How many times do you have to fire yourself on a Friday? Come back and do it on Monday. Is that, as a long-standing CEO, is the pace of that accelerating now?
It is. I think that discipline is was foundational for me to continue to have fresh eyes at the company. I mean, the beauty of being in the job 10 years is that, you know, the experience of the cycles, you do know the business very, very well. The counter to that is that, you know, I always worry that I'm going to become, you know, too historic in the way I think about this. And I think you can't rely on history. You have to have a vision for the future. So this thought that I was forced to do sort of at that five-year juncture, I mean, it's a monthly thought. You know, I'm constantly kind of reassessing after a meeting. Did I think about that in a fresh enough way? If I were somebody else, would I do that the same way? And it's a forced discipline that's really, I think, quite healthy. And I talk a lot about it with our senior team to make sure they do that too.
I have a very quick two-part question. Of your revenue, do you see more of your revenue now coming in from the global, you know, outside of U.S.? And then during the recessionary period, particularly towards the end of 08, early 09, how did that shift? Did you see actually a decline in U.S. and more coming from
there? Yes. I mean, in on a good day, we continue to see, just because global GDP, if you just follow global GDP, again, the percent of our business that's in developing and emerging markets, which even before 2009 had higher GDP, that was where the growth trajectory was. So 75% of our business today is in the developing and emerging or outside U.S. world, and that certainly was even stronger in this recessionary period. But on average, I think it's going to be close to 80% of the company's growth coming from the developing and emerging world, which is why I think we're going to gain share, because that is where the consumer spend is growing the fastest.
I know you built a large R&D facility in Suffern, New York. Was that a difficult decision? With so many U.S. companies going abroad, you stayed here and built it here in the United States, which we all applaud you for doing that. Was that a difficult decision?
No, it wasn't a difficult decision. What we have done is we've also established some small satellite R&Ds in some critical parts of the world. So we have a small satellite R&D in Shanghai, and we have a small satellite R&D in Sao Paulo, Brazil, which is our largest market today. And we're looking at one in Europe. But the lion's share of the, you know, we have 300 plus scientists, and et cetera, and we've been able to attract them from all over the world. It was, for us, interesting because we actually built this R&D facility on the original site where the founder started the business. So there's also historic meaning to the company, and proud to give the jobs here in the United States.
Yes. When you spoke about the Avon representatives, you know, extending the advertising reach through Facebook or other social networking, is it challenging all of the representatives that maybe don't have access to the internet? Or, I mean, that's a large portion.
Yes, 88% of the United States representatives are online. And I can give you an interesting number because I just looked at it yesterday. 1 year ago, 6% of our representatives in Russia were online. As of yesterday, 76% were online of 800,000 representatives. So the move to the internet, independent of Avon, is an extraordinary acceleration around the world. I mean, it is clearly the community. I mean, you know, we say to our representatives, you need to get online because it'll help your business, but you're not going to be able to help your children do their homework. You will not be able to live as a modern woman if you do not know how to use the internet in a developing and emerging market. And we can help you through business tools, but it will have broader application than just running your Avon business if you understand how to go online and understand the power of it. So just as an information an education tool. So this is a rapid movement that I've never seen anything like, the expansion of internet usage. And it's a game changer for us, for the sales force.
Two more quick questions,
so
please.
Many questions.
I have two different questions to ask you. The first is, very briefly, how do you motivate your team? What is it that really gets them going, that gets them fired up? And the second question is, you mentioned India and China. I'm from Pakistan. What about Pakistan? Women in Pakistan are very beauty conscious,
yes,
and they would love to have Avon products, so why not Pakistan?
Well, I'll answer that first, and that is, Pakistan is also on our list of expansion in rising Asia. We think that the opportunity is huge there. For us, when we just look at the number of women, in India and Pacistan, the opportunity to be micro lenders and to, you know, usage of the product, but the opportunity to help change society there, we feel very passionate about it. How do we motivate? We're very fortunate in the company. Fred mentioned the purpose of the company and a lot of the philanthropic work. This year, was a tough year for all companies, but we just actually got the engagement score of our associates back, which is at an all-time high. And the answer behind that, as we peeled the onion, was a combination of the fact that our associates feel like they're part of the solution, but also because of the work we do in the foundation, the social purpose. I think all of us, yes, we're doing business and we're, you know, aiming to get earnings per share up for shareholders, but in the constituent base of community, and I think a world that needs corporations to do good, we've raised over $725 million for women's health, breast cancer, but also domestic violence. We took on an initiative this year, or 3 years ago, but really heightened it this year when we could have pulled back, but we went forward very strongly to eliminate violence against women, particularly with the statistics we have of 80% of our business being outside the U.S. and the incidence of oppression against women, everything from sexual slavery that still exists in the Central and Eastern European countries to violence which occurs across the world, unfortunately. We have been extremely focused on making sure our associate base knows that we're going to still do good things. This may be a tough economic climate, but the company has been around and will be around because we have a purpose to help women not only make money, but give back to the community. That's been critical. So, you know, you always talk about missions and values, and they're not on a boardroom wall. I mean, when it comes to life in tough times is when it is very motivational for an organization, and we have used our recommitment to the original purpose of the company to keep people sort of grounded and focused that this is going to pass, but we're going to be a better company because of it, because the world needs us to do these good things for women.
Yes. When you first became CEO, what were the initial steps that you took to seize the moment that was being given to you?
That's a great question, and that's a little bit part of this thought of rehiring myself now and trying to do the same thing. I mean, I think, you know, you have that first clean sheet of 100 days. They write books about it in terms of what are you going to do your first 100 days, and how are you going to communicate and derive a strategy. I think the most important thing then, which is still the most important thing now, 10 years later, is the role of frequent communication and personal communication to the organization. I can't underestimate. Sometimes I think to myself, as I'm going through, we've made such a radical change, are the people going to be tired of hearing me talk about the same thing? And the feedback is, no, we need to hear it, that it is the sustained message that you're staying the course that, you know, and it's not always an easy message. It's not always a rallying, rah-rah message. Sometimes it's a tough message, but consistent, clear vision and communication from leadership, including the CEO, you can't do that enough. And that, so I went out on the road. I went out on the road and touched over thousands of associates in my first 100 days, and I still do that now. Every year, because I realize the power of it, I go out and recommunicate. What is the vision? What is the strategy? Town hall, Q&A, do people still understand what we're trying to do here? Good year or tougher quarter? And that's been, I think, one of my lessons learned that I keep forcing us to do as a discipline. If you over-communicate, actually, you will see amazing results. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Andrea, for that inspiring and informative speech. It's not every day that you hear a CEO that not only leads an innovative company, but furthers entrepreneurship around the world and gives back to the community. I mean, there's only a handful of folks like that, and we are so pleased to have you share your wisdom with us today. I'd like to call up Dean William Moore, Provost Ken Green, and Fred Hassan to give a small token of our appreciation to you. And my staff convinced me to do something very creative and different than I usually do, is give a gift made from a local female entrepreneur, handmade piece of jewelry that I haven't seen yet, or paid for yet. Now, the point is, from an entrepreneur, a local entrepreneur, And that we think that sort of identifies with what you and your company does.
Thank you.
And we hope to have you back someday to share, you know, all the wild growth that Avon has achieved in the coming near future.
Thank
so
you.
Stay right here and we'll take a quick picture. Come on up, Fred and Ken. And I'd also like to thank Fred for personally being involved with this innovation program and making it so successful. Fred was also very helpful in securing Andrea for this talk, and we hope in the months and years to come, we look forward to his continued involvement with our innovation programs. No.